Scotland is a North Island nation of drunkards, misfits, prophets and bigots, all suffering to some degree from an inferiority complex, a tendency to whinge and good old-fashioned heart disease. We also harbour some of the finest imaginative thinking in the world. To show Scotland and Glasgow as it really might be, it is necessary to avoid resorting to the clichés of Celtic cosiness, country dancing, kilts, whisky, Clydeside cranes and the great green outdoors. You will see from this film that we've failed on every count. So what makes a typical Scotsman? Well, a sturdy set of thighs for ganting up hillsides, a wonderful sense of humour, except when it comes to jokes about pandas, and a constant thirst and raging appetite, and an angelic voice when he's drunk.
The wrong guy, the wrong situation, the right time, the roll of me.
Your typical Scot is underpaid, overweight, who has a great enthusiasm for life, which is tempered by a great cynicism about other people.
Look into your heart, pretty baby, is it aching with some nameless need? Is there something wrong and you can't put your finger on it? Right then, roll to me.
Difference with the English? Well, I mean, your Scotsman would definitely classify the English as sort of mean-spirited and sort of slightly arrogant, and these are the cliches, you understand. Yeah, Englishmen are generally better at football though than Scotsmen, which is a kind of a worry for the Scots.
And I don't think I have ever seen a soul so in despair. So if you want to talk the man through, guess who will be there?
Typical Scot.
Well, the guys I know, your average jock guy, the wallet must be very tight, you know that?
And they eat a lot of this stuff called pakora.
They like that?
You get it in the shops, I don't know, I've never heard of it.
They're also always behind you at the bar, so you buy the drinks and they're, yeah.
The jewel in the crown of this terrible little second-hand nation is capital Edinburgh, Athens of the North, handsome, striking and riddled with ancient heritage. Glasgow, my home and industrial nexus, is the buckle in the belt. Glasgow really was a powerhouse of industrial production, even in my lifetime. Coal, steel, automobiles, trains, and the finest ocean-going ships in the world were manufactured minutes from most Glaswegians' homes in the 60s. Look at the fool you have been. They drained the pool while you drowned in the dream. When I was a kid, every New Year's Eve at 12 o'clock, all the ships up and down the river would blow their horns, and you used to stick your head out the window like 5 miles from here, and you'd just hear this amazing noise of, you know, an incredible noise. And then 5 years later, you'd stick your head out the window and it'd be like, beep, beep. There'd be like one ship left, you know. They bought your beauty and your soul, then softly
sold you back what they stole. I mean, I remember when I was younger, the centre of the town was like really filthy and all the buildings were black and they had much more of an industrial feel to it, and they were sort of cleaned up all the town centre, and there's lots of wine bars and bookshops and nice record stores and all that kind of stuff. But at the same time, what really made the city, what kept the city alive, all the kind of car factories and the shipyards, they've all closed, which is sort of ripping the heart out of the town. When you were young, when you were young,
one of the big, I think it's the Queen Mary or something, one of the big ocean liners that they built on Clydeside came back for the first time in like something like 50 years or something. A couple of years ago, and the ship came right up the river, and there was all these like old guys standing on the side of the river, like weeping, you know, crying, because it was the first time they'd seen this ship that they built. They were really proud of.
There was that much work, it was unbelievable. Anybody that wanted to work, worked. Right, but what you've got to remember is other countries come into the market and started building ships.
Taiwan,
Japan,
Korea.
And they started building ships with their technology, but with government subsidies.
In general, there's a great upsurge in the art side of life in Glasgow, etc. But the shipyard, the upsurge is non-existent. It's totally gone.
A shipyard just keep the workers going. It keeps everything round about, going round about it. All the shops.
Outlying district.
Everything. The food shops, the chip shop, that keeps all them going round about them. And if a shipyard goes, they go.
This was once all sweat. Now it's just damp, like the political culture that allowed it to vanish. We produce little of note these days. An author or two, a painter or three, a clutch of cynical pop singers congenitally trapped in a time warp of reassuring melody. Snow in a solar city covers up the cracks in the road as a wastrel buys her cigarettes and wipes her pretty nose. Like a part-time Elvis Imitri, these streets I knew so well have been pasted beyond recognition with a temporary smell. Now the midnight train eases out, leaving everyone marooned. And without her, it might as well be
that's art.
So from the well-swept streets of Jackson Heights to the dark side of drudgery, everything's now a replica of what it used to be. But since they tied it up
just blue. It seems less like a home to me than just a place they bury you. Now we're lit up like a cathedral in our frozen concrete room. Without her, it might as well be the surface of the moon. Yeah, for all I care, it might as well be the surface of the moon.
Well, this is the Barra's Market. This is the epitome of everything that is the cliche, the Glasgow cliche. It's just a whole load of junk, really. But it's a kind of social occasion. You come here with a terrible hangover on a Saturday morning or a Sunday morning, which is much better, actually. You just leaf through lots of rubbish, you know, second-hand paperbacks and records that you never wanted in the first place, and you go home with armfuls of rubbish and you throw it all out the next year. But I get it anyway. We're actually too late because it's now nearly 5 o'clock, which means everything is closed and all there is left is actually genuinely rubbish.
So you kind of come here to get rid of your hangover. It's a traditional hangover cure.
Have we got rid of a hangover?
People's hangovers are generally gone by 4 o'clock in the afternoon. So I got out of sync.
Well, let's go home. We're here in the Highland Dress Hire, which is where everybody gets their skirts for weddings, skirts that men wear. These are the skirts that men wear. And Sadie here is going to measure me up for a man's skirt. The old cliche about, what do?
Well, just... I take your measurements round the waist first.
Okay. The old cliche about kilts is that Scotsmen don't wear anything under their kilt, which I found to be very hazardous on past occasions. And I always wear two pairs of pants under a kilt. One normal pair of pants and a pair of safety pants. Which I recommend to any foreign types who are thinking about wearing a skirt. This is a major faux pas. I shouldn't have trousers on. Always make sure you have pleats at the back, because some idiotic Americans sometimes wear them the wrong way around and the pleats are at the front, and that's. A long sock.
No, it's a bit of a safety sock.
Actually, I should have washed my feet this morning, shouldn't I?
Scottish people.
Nobody's perfect, and that's something that I'm sure she'll know. Is trying to tell her lies from the truth at times is like trying to divide ice from snow. And when I knew it was over, I jumped into a taxi and said, just guess where to go. And the driver turned about and said, finding what you want is like trying to divide ice from snow. So here I sit, rolling back to bed, knowing love's a hazard that I'd never guessed. But from this side of the moon, I couldn't care less. I couldn't care less.
Here we are on the Renfrew Ferry, which is a ferry basically used to go across the Clyde and take you from the north coast to the south coast of the Clyde, or from the north to the south of Glasgow. This is where you bring your foreign friends
if you live in Glasgow and you want to show them a bit of Scottish culture and you can't be bothered actually going to Scotland, which is all the bit outside of Glasgow. They've just called my dance, I have to go. Football in Glasgow is fiercely divided down religious and cultural lines, whereas other British cities support their football teams because they like the colour they're playing in. In Glasgow, people support one team or the other because their grandparents came from Ireland or their grandparents came from some bastion of hatred in Scotland. So it's something that's best avoided if you're an atheist like myself.
Yeah.
But here we are wearing the wearing the two conflicting strips of Scottish cultural hatred.
And
I think this says brothers. We are family. We can all get on, but I still hate Rangers.
A struck match faded like a nervous laugh beyond the halo of a naked bulb, and your low voice mingles with your other half's school friends and secondhand clothes. Eventually your world will shrink within four walls of neglected depths and stolen stereos. So move away, Jimmy Blow, before your small, small town turns around and swallows you.
And you ground that down and you mix it up with hot water and you down in around Marston, and then you drain it off, which is called sweet works, and it's pumped up in here into this wooden wash box where the yeast is added and the fermentation starts. Now you'll see the vigorous reaction as it generates up its heat, and it'll start to froth up and start to come over the door.
Well, the bus is pulling out, and I guess I'd better go before I make a grave mistake and let my feelings show.
I think it's just the atmosphere and the climate. I think it's the main thing for making a whiskey.
Be my downfall, be my great regret, be the one girl that I'll never forget. Be my undoing, be my slow road to ruin tonight.
Well, this is a kind of temple to the Scotsman's downfall, which they stupidly call Uisge Beth, which means the water of life, but it's definitely been more people's downfall than benefit. This is definitely the place to come when you acquire too much of a love for whiskey, because they have some extremely expensive things in here, so you can behave like a dilettante and buy the expensive things, which is probably one of the few ways that Scotsmen like myself restrict their drinking. Justin has one of my favourites here, which comes from the Isle of Skye.
Never touched the stuff myself, but...
Like all barmen,
Yeah.
You see too many drunks on the other side of the bar.
Is that about right?
It's pretty big.
Is it?
Yeah.
You've been in America too long, mate.
Absolutely. A proper Scottish measure would only just cover the bottom of this glass, which is very disappointing when it costs £3 or £4 a glass, but...
Slange.
The one song people here insist on us playing was written in 1987, nearly 10 years ago. Whether it was ever a hit because people thought it was about something is open to conjecture. I think people liked the tune and the words just filled in the blanks. I used to always write in a bay window overlooking Great Western Road and Kelvin Bridge. I suppose this was what I thought my life consisted of. A few years later, the wall had come down, I had a job singing in public, and Margaret Thatcher was gone. The more things change, the more they stay the same.
Post office clerks put up signs saying position closed. Secretaries turn off their typewriters and put up their coats.
Janitors padlock their gates for security guards to patrol.
And bachelors phone up their friends for a drink.
While the married ones turned on the chat show, they will all be lonely tonight and lonely tomorrow.
Gentlemen, time please, you know we can't serve anymore. Now the traffic lights change to stop when there's nothing to go. And by 5 o'clock everything's dead, and every third car is a cab. And ignorant people sleep in their beds like the dope white mice in the college lab. And nothing ever happens, nothing happens at all. The needle returns to the start of the song and we all...
So this is it, this is the real Scotland. Men in kilts, Iain trying to play the bagpipes very well, whiskey, ridiculous clothes, and of course some rain. Scotland wouldn't be complete without rain. So, as you can see, it's a miserable feeling. I've heard you play better.
When you're driving with the brakes on, when you're swimming with your boots on, it's hard to say you love someone, and it's hard to say you're done. But unless the moon falls tonight, unless continents collide, nothing's gonna make me break from her side. 'Cause when you're driving with the brakes on, when you're swimming